This video is going to introduce section 12.5, which is on solving rational equations, and this will be the first of two videos on this. So, by now we have had quite a bit of experience with what rational equations are, what rational functions are, rational expressions, how to simplify them, how to multiply, divide, add, and subtract them, and even how to put that to work in terms of solving larger structures called complex fractions. Now, similar to when we covered all the factoring techniques and then used them to solve quadratic equations, we're now going to apply everything we know to solving rational equations. And that is sort of the rational function version of the quadratic one, which is just to take rational expressions or equations, or to take rational expressions and throw them into an equation together. That will be the first time we'll see them with explicit equal signs. So let me give an example of this to show what I mean. Here is what I'll call a rational equation for the first time. 2 over y plus 1 equals 3 over y. And notice this. On their own, these are both fairly simple rational expressions, you know, or rational functions, if you like. But we remember that that just means something written as a ratio of polynomials. These both qualify. But it's an equation between the two. And when this was the quadratic equations, we were playing the game of setting it equal to zero somehow, using factoring, and then using the zero product property to solve. And that isn't exactly the way here. So to begin to solve this, we're asking, is there even a value for y that makes these two sides the same? And I want to show you a method that is a little more methodical and cautious than the way taught in ORCA. So what I'd like to encourage you to do is to look at your quadratic equation and to look at the two denominators that we have, y plus 1 and y, and to ask what between them is their least common denominator, similar to what we were asking when we were trying to add or subtract rational expressions in section 12.3. And since these two are, you know, implicitly in parentheses and different enough, neither is a multiple of the other, the LCD is just the product of the two. Y times y plus 1. We've seen that before. And so before we get to the new method of solving these, what I encourage you to do and what I'm going to do here is to, in side work, rewrite both of these expressions with a common denominator. So first of all, 2 over y plus 1. It's as if I were going to add them, but there's a different method, a different goal here. And I want to multiply it by, well, what is it missing from its LCD? Y over y. And as before, I can just leave the denominator in factored form. In fact, there's no real benefit to foiling it. But 2 times y is 2y. And hopefully if you stare at that, you can convince yourself that that really is just 2 over y plus 1 in disguise. So what about the other one? 3 over y is missing the y plus 1 from the LCD that we decided. And nice thing about this setup is it always guarantees that we get the LCD that we intended. But now the numerator is something a little more interesting. Distributing the 3 gives us, I think, 3y plus 3. So these are the rewritten versions of the two original rational expressions. And now I set them back into an equation and I say, well, that means they are 2y over your denominator, and 3y plus 3 over the denominator. Denominators match. Why do all this? The reason is, now let me get this out of here and move this over a little bit. We would like to, there's a, you know, our ultimate goal, worth saying, is to get y equals something on the ground. Right now there are y's all throughout this equation. We would like to clean that up as much as possible. There are y's in the numerators and the denominators all over. So the purpose of this is I'd like to start by clearing my denominators. And now that they are both the same as each other, let me move them over a little bit so I can have some space for this, I can do this very nice move. If I just sort of bundle each one up inside a larger parenthesis And since I have an equation here, I can now a little more aggressively, a little more freely do anything I want to one side as long as I do it to the other side. The move that will clear my denominators very efficiently is to multiply both sides by the denominator itself. Why will that do the job? Because that is essentially itself over one, and you can see cancellation. I won't in general write that one, but that's what's going on. So if I do that there and balance it by doing it over here as well, this is the payoff to having preset our denominators to match. Because if you multiply both sides by that denominator, you get a clean, kind of symmetric cancellation and a fair one. And what's the punchline of that? The denominators become ones and essentially cease to exist, and the numerators fall to the ground. 2y equals 3y plus 3. Now, if you're looking at that cancellation thinking, well, what about the restrictions on inputs? I will come back and address that momentarily. I haven't forgotten that. But if you're with me so far, it seems that that has kind of leveled the problem down to pretty nice, gentle pieces. In fact, we could solve this pretty directly. We could subtract 2y from both sides, maybe get the y's on the right. That'd give me 0 equals y plus 3. The end is in sight now. Subtract 3, and I get negative 3 equals y, or y equals 3. Sorry, negative 3, and that is a solution to this rational equation. So I want to point out two things before I go on to the next example. First of all, I do want to check this and see if it holds up to the original context, but also we could just see kind of from the very beginning that because of this piece, y could not be 0. That would be not allowed in the original form of the equation. And also, whoops, because of this piece, y could not be negative 1. So we had some sort of implicit restrictions on what numbers we were allowed to get out of this, or might have had to throw away. But when we played it out and the solution we got wasn't either of those, that means that's a valid solution. So I can, very cautiously accept that that's the solution to this equation. The only other thing I want to do is check it. And this is when the check is going to return, is a very useful thing. Check our solution. What does it mean? It means to take the original equation, copy too much here, and now replace our y's with negative threes. Let's see if it makes a true statement. Negative 3 plus 1 over negative 3. Let's see. Well, negative 3 plus 1 is negative 2, so is 2 over negative 2 equal to 3 over negative 3? I think if we look at that, however you want to think about it, you can agree that that is true because both sides are equal to negative 1. And so essentially, the check here is good if you get a two sides equal to the same thing. Negative 1 is equal to itself. Seems a bit silly to say, but that's just verifying that our number was good. And that is essentially the method of solving rational equations in this way. So I'll do one more example in this video. In the second video, I'll do a kind of context word problem version of this. But let's see, how about here's another one? A little more interesting, because it's going to look sort of strange. X plus 1 over, whoops, x minus 4 equals, so now it's an equation because that equal sign is there, x minus 3 divided by x minus 4. And remember the implied parentheses if you are tempted to cancel any x's. This is definitely an equation. There are definitely rational pieces in it. And this doesn't look rational, but I will say we now know that it can be, since we want to sort of live in this in a consistent rational space, x is the same as x over 1. So I'll write it like so. And now is a good time to once again say, well, we do have sort of three rational pieces, and I'd like to clean up as much as I can or preset as much as I can by finding the least common denominator between all three of them. I think that we are in luck here because these two already have the same denominator of x minus 4, so that definitely belongs in the LCD. But since this is just a denominator of 1, I can turn it into this denominator of x minus 4 pretty directly, and it doesn't offer anything new. A multiple of 1 is not adding anything new to the pile, so I think we are in luck. This is a pretty gentle LCD of x minus 4 for the whole problem, which is great. It just means that these two don't need to be built up. Only this one does. So that's all I'll do in terms of my side work. Take the x over 1 off to the side and multiply it by what I need to get the denominator of x minus 4, which I know is x minus 4 itself. Now this is where, oh, there is a slight cost to this, which is I've stressed repeatedly that you leave your denominators in factored form, but you FOIL your numerators. So there was an x, we're multiplying by x plus 4, x minus 4, so we actually get a quadratic, x squared minus 4x. Cool. And now what does that do in the context? Well, previously x over 1 is now x squared minus 4x over x minus 4. Adding to that the 1, and it was equal to x minus 3 over x minus 4. So just to pause here, we're like right in the halfway point, and now all the pieces have the same denominator. So I feel like I could make the argument that I want to multiply both sides by the x minus 4 to clear the denominators now, but I'm going to hold off because I'm going to take that one extra step where these two combine, by the rules of 12.3, because their denominators are the same. Let's just merge them so we have fewer moving parts. Same denominator, so they become over x minus 4, x squared minus 4x from the first piece, and then the plus 1 just safely slots in there. And you may be thinking about that from a factoring perspective, but since I'm not quite to the end yet, I'm going to hold off on that just for now. But hopefully that merger seems okay. Now it's equal this over x minus 4. And now is the time to make the move that we've set ourselves up for. Wrap everything up in a parenthesis just for safekeeping. And if we want to clear the denominator, and we have the same denominator on both sides, we will multiply by that denominator on both sides safely. And this time I will pause. Because you can see that the denominators are about to cancel, and you can see that of all the denominators we have, the only restriction seems to be that x could not equal 4. I just want to write that down so that in the I can weigh my future answers against it. Now I can cancel. And as before, very nice payoff to this is all those cancel and all the numerators just fall to the ground. X squared minus 4x plus 1 over here is equal to x minus 3. Now here's a moment I really want to appreciate, because compared to this version here, where when we made that move, we got just kind of y's on the ground with no exponents beyond 1, and it was a pretty direct solution process. Solving this rational equation, which kind of along the way created an x squared, when we made that cleanup move here, it landed us here, which if you stare at that is a quadratic equation. So sometimes nested in the process of solving a rational equation, it will change form to become a quadratic equation, and which means that we solve it in the way that we solve quadratic equations by getting zero on one side and then factoring. So we're going to do that to finish this problem. I'll just bring everything to the left, take away the x, and add the 3, try to be orderly. And it's going to be x squared. This is another good reason why we didn't want to factor this too soon. X squared minus 5x plus 4, I think, equals 0. And looking at that, I believe it is factorable. Two numbers that multiply to 4 and add to negative 5 are negative 1 and negative 4. So the factor is there. X minus 1 and x minus 4 equals 0. Now, we can sort of see the solution staring us in the face, but the zero product property, as our friend still says, well, if x minus 1 is 0, we win, and if x minus 4 is 0, we win. solving them separately. Remember, this is a genuine quadratic equation. We're not hunting for domain restrictions here. This is actually looking for solutions, potential solutions. So what do we get? X is 1 and x equals 4 are the solutions to this quadratic equation. And since that came from a rational equation, implicitly they're the solutions to the rational equation as well. But the only difference is, if you recall, right here, when we made the multiplication, we noted the domain restrictions of the original setup and said that because of the structure that was there, 4 can't be a solution. So we kind of preemptively stated that. And now that we're at the end, we see that we have two solutions, and one of them is 4. So that number has to be thrown out. That solution is what you call extraneous. It's no good because it showed up in the process, but it doesn't hold up against the original conditions of the problem, so it's no good. So I only keep the solution of x equals 1. And I will check that, and then that'll be enough for this video. But again, very important that it can happen when a rational equation, you're going through it, solving it, and it turns form to a quadratic, and you solve it the quadratic, you might find an extraneous solution. There's nothing wrong with that, it just is a possibility. So let's just check this, and then we'll call it good. This original equation, a lot of moving parts here seemingly, but we just want to verify that is it true that if we plug in x equals 1, this is true. 1 over 1 plus 1 over 1 minus 4, fraction work. 1 minus 3 over 1 minus 4. I hope this works. Well, I know that 1 over 1 is 1, and 1 over 1 minus 4 is negative 1/3. Okay. And what's this other one? Negative 2 over negative 3? Yeah, and those two negatives cancel. Is it true that 1 minus 1/3 is 2/3? It is true. We could verify that by saying that 1 over 1 is 3 over 3, if we like. Yeah. So the answer checks out, and our solution to this one will just be the number 1, since we excluded the 4.